to be those guys manhandling. Oh, hello, hello, hello. How's everybody doing? Yeah? Come on, guys.
Anyone getting caffeine?
Yeah, we got caffeine going. We're all happy. Don had an amazing lunch.
I did have lunch. I got Paul to pay, which was even more amazing than the lunch.
That's a big feat.
It is.
I'm just kidding. Okay. All righty. So welcome back to both our live and our remote audiences today. We are so pleased for those joining us from Prince George, Kelowna, and other regions of our great province. How many of you out there are from the interior? Okanagan. I heard there's a huge representation today, so that is awesome.
Those are fun people.
They are fun people. We'll have to hang out with them later. So we're excited about this part of the program, but we need your help. We are about to bring several groups to the stage. They're going to have, or individuals, to pitch their big idea, and you guys get to vote on it. So here's what's going to happen. One by one, they're going to come up. They're going to have 4 minutes. There's a timer, and you're going to hear meh. That's not a very good meet. What does it sound like? What does it sound like?
Something like that. Oh, there we go.
Kind of like that. Okay. Then Don and I get a minute to grill them, and then boom, we kick them off stage, and the next person comes up.
Right.
At the very end of it, you guys need to vote throughout it, or you'll have 2 minutes at the very end as well.
Yeah. So if you fall in love with someone in the middle, you could vote or wait till the end. Get your app out. Get it downloaded.
Get your app out right now. Get it downloaded. That's exactly what we need to do.
And it does matter because there is going to be some money online.
There is. Rumor has it that they're getting about $5,000 cash.
Yep.
And IBM is forking up, I think, about $100,000 or $120,000 in services.
Yeah. So the people who are pitching care. So
you,
please participate.
Right? Thank you, IBM.
Please participate.
Yeah. Okay. All right. We ready? A lot of pressure.
Okay.
You guys ready to vote? Okay, well, before, just teasing you a little bit, before we get started, we are going to invite Neville Noop, Business Unit Executive from IBM's Cloud Services Division from Canada, to kick things off. Come on up, Neville. Dun, 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 dun. Okay.
Good afternoon, everybody. They promised me the clicker would be right here. There it is. Good afternoon. I'm very proud to represent IBM here as the platinum sponsor for BCTECH's inaugural event and to introduce the Innovation Showcase. From what I've seen so far of today, this will be the first of many of these sessions to come. We're excited for the future of the event. We're all keenly aware of the impact of digital disruption to industries as we know them. Netflix, one of the world's largest movie houses, owns no theaters. Airbnb, one of the largest accommodation companies, owns no real estate. And Uber, one of the world's largest taxi companies, owns no cars. These were all impressive innovations and fantastic examples of digital disruption in their time. But this is the world of technology. And this is a highly innovative province, and we all know nothing stands still for long. To stay ahead, we all must move ahead at cloud speed. Those innovations were so 2016. Welcome to the cognitive era, a new era of technology, business, and thinking.
I am a technological breakthrough.
This morning, I read over 4,000 articles on leukemia in less than a second.
Thousands of new laws were published yesterday, and I'm up to speed on all of them.
I know every detail of every public quarterly report in the last 20 years.
I can spot diseases before a patient displays a single symptom.
I can understand euphemisms, idiosyncrasies, and complex metaphors.
I can tell what's going to sell out before it ever trends online.
I can forecast the weather in over 2.2 billion locations at the same time!
I can grow with you.
I can coach you.
Enrich you.
Enlighten you.
And I'm just getting warmed up.
Hello, my name is Watson. Together, we can outthink the limits of what's possible. Welcome to the cognitive era.
The cognitive era is here. Thank you. Watson, a truly first-of-a-kind capability that can learn, reason, understand data, and enhance our own comprehension and enable us to accelerate to a whole new level of man-machine interface with assistive technology to achieve things we never thought possible. Yes, Watson can speak multiple languages and provide translation to allow you to communicate with somebody who may not speak your mother tongue. But even more important is the cognitive capability of this technology allows it to understand you and what you say and what you want it to do to help you. It predicts what will happen next, and it spots trends before they start. Watson digests available information in all forms, the kind of information that traditional databases did not allow us to access, and therefore makes possible applications and use cases that we haven't seen before. It generates its own hypotheses, it considers arguments, and it makes fact-based recommendations. Sounds like I'm describing a person. This isn't just a PowerPoint or a video or shelfware that I'm describing, it's very, very real. A team of U of T students built ROS, a cognitive solution that takes what used to require many hours of legal research down to a task that's accomplished for a lawyer in seconds. SoftBank in Japan uses Pepper the robot, powered by Watson, to engage their clients in coffee shops and in bank branches. In coffee shops, Pepper's sales of coffee machines are up to a level not anticipated by SoftBank, and in the bank, clients are listening to Pepper's wealth management advice and expertise in making decisions to acquire products. So successful, in fact, SoftBank's plan is to roll the technology out into 1,000 of their coffee shops, and the next step is 100 of the bank branches from the current pilot of 10. Cognitive toys are now a reality with the power of Watson, and they can have a personalized interaction with a child to help him or her learn things on their own terms, in their own language, at their own speed, and to their level of their own interest. This sure isn't the Chatty Cathy we grew up with, and it's not Tickle Me Elmo either. It's not even the latest Fisher-Price tablet. This is advanced learning, packaged and consumable in a toy for a child that allows them to accelerate what they know about the world and how they experience the world at a pace that was unthinkable in the past. And right here at home in Surrey, BC, Purple Forge and Watson enable a mobile application to help citizens with self-service information by answering their questions, spoke to the system in their natural language to help them find their way around services here in the city. And you can see Purple Forge in the booth at the end of the exhibit hall out towards where all the universities and other young entrepreneurs are showing off their wares. Applications like this have one common need. They need what we call, our chairman coined the phrase, the world's next natural resource, and that is data. The key to making all of this happen is access to consumable data sources from around the world, which is why we have partnerships with many companies on an open basis, including Twitter, Facebook, Apple, the Weather Company, and many companies here in Canada, one notably today, Think DataWorks, a small startup out of Toronto, who have now made available all of the open government data at the federal and provincial level available in a simple user interface for anybody who wants to take such things as nutritional data, census data, and the other things that the government provides us and turn those into useful applications. Now, I hope you're all as excited as we are to take part in changing the world with this technology, and an early leapfrog to this level by this province will indelibly put not only BC Tech but BC itself on the IT map for a very long time to come, and the IBM team is about working with others to make that happen. And in fact, today, we're going to make it very real for one lucky company who will win this afternoon's innovation showcase. With the power of IBM Cloud, the computing technology we've talked about here, and the investment in resource and mentoring for the company, we will help them take the innovation they started to this level to commercialize their company and not only grow it here in Canada, but keep it here in Canada, so that we can improve the country as a whole with the kind of companies who invent the ideas that they do and want to take them to market. Without further ado, let's get to the competition and find out who will be the next BC entrepreneur to make their mark in this new cognitive era. Thank you.
Thank you, Neville.
Thank you, Neville.
Don, do you want to
All right, let's call up our first person. We have Dave McLeod, CEO of Thought Exchange.
Dave.
Hi, everyone.
Hey, Dave.
Hey.
Thanks, Dave. Am I ready to go? My timer started, but my thing's not on. All right. So, hi, I'm Dave. I'm going to attempt to give you 5 years of Thought Exchange in 4 minutes. Bear with me. So, Thought Exchange, what's the problem that we solve? Well, group discussions don't work very well, especially online. And our solution is that we've built software to help you lead great group conversations with 5,000 to 50,000 people. And that's a lofty claim. So, 3 steps make it work. First, that you ask people to share their thoughts to open-ended questions. They do that independently. Next, everyone actually considers the thoughts of one another, and that's really important. They put stars on the ones that they think is most important, and those stars are in limited supply. Because of those starring patterns, we actually can discover what matters most to the group and to individuals within the group, and we have algorithms and patent-pending visualizations that help you do that. So, if you participated in this process, you might have put one of these thoughts down. But then you see thoughts of other people, and you go, you know what? I actually like that thought. So you're going to put your stars. Maybe you'll put your stars on someone else's thought, because maybe that thought was actually more interesting than your own, believe it or not. What happens when you do that is we can actually do something kind of cool. Cole's Notes version of this. This is about 2,000 people. It's a visualization of a conversation. They're trying to raise about $200 million, and they ask the question, open-ended, what are your concerns about a couple of scenarios? It's a school district. So, you see, when we analyze people's thoughts, we can actually put the thoughts and the people in groups. So, you see here, there's this group over here. This is the anti-football stadium, don't build a football stadium with this money group. There's a thought about it. There's a group over here, which is build a football stadium. Whatever you do, build the football stadium. And there's a group over here saying safety, security, technology. Here's the aha. The survey would say, it's 50-50. The size of this group, this circle here, is about the size of that group there, right? So in a poll or a survey, you'd say 50-50. And in fact, the superintendent was in this group. She said, every other person tells me to build a football stadium. But with Thought Exchange, people put stars on thoughts. And as they put stars on thoughts, what happens is that they change their mind. They learn, and they adopt a different point of view. And we can actually animate the learning that happens when you do that. So what's cool about that is that, see this pro football stadium group over there? Well, it turns out that that group shrunk a lot, and they actually cared more about these issues of safety and security and technology, as well as the don't build the football stadium group. So what that means is, as a company, we've actually worked in all provinces and most territories, and we're now in 22 states and counting, because it turns out understanding groups of people and what motivates them is pretty valuable. I also want to note on this map that we're located, our head office is in Rosslyn, BC, in the Kootenays. Yep, and we have an office down here in Port Moody, another one in Vancouver. Our highlights is that we sold $5 million last year after tripling our sales since 2011. We've raised $12 million from some of Canada's top angels. We started in education, and now we're expanding into the corporate space. We're creating new products for all sizes groups, and our total addressable market, we feel, is effectively all organizations with leaders who want to build better relationships while they make better decisions. So that's pretty big. And so it's sort of our thing to screw up, I think. So as far as our team, right now we have a workforce of 65, and it comes from Creo, which was, many of you'll know, a unicorn sold for $1 billion about 10 years ago. So led by me, I'm the CEO. There's Jim, he's our he was a principal consultant or principal engineer at Creo, and Amos was the CEO. So our two asks, one, you should probably vote for General Fusion when they're up next and we want to change the world, but they need to save it first. Two, we're doubling the size of our company, so come talk to us.
Dave.
Thank you, Dave.
You rocked it. That was a good 4 minutes.
Good 4 minutes. Now, Dave, before you run away, we're going to grill you with some questions.
Sorry, I forgot about that part.
Do you want to jump in or?
Go first, Lindsay.
I'm curious, you said you're going to expand into corporate. What 3 areas of corporate?
Good. So we want to do customer engagement. So we reach out to our customers and we hear about what their concerns are and what their hopes are, and not just their first thought, best thought, but what they value as a group, so we can develop products for them that we know is going to be valuable to our whole customer base. Staff engagement, we're really interesting. We use it internally a lot to hear back from our staff to get some sort of sense of what's important to them. And that's the third one. I don't know. We'll go from there. There's two.
That's pretty great. What are you learning from scarcity as people apply their votes? The star system sort of looked like a great way for your customers to link to ideas. If it's 20, do people vote differently?
What are we learning from scarcity?
Yeah, your stars, as you apply it to the questions.
Oh, you mean when they, because they have a limited supply?
Yeah.
What happens is that there's an important cognitive thing is that you look at the thoughts and you actually have to think about them more deeply. You apply your stars really quickly, and through that scarcity, they actually have to deeply consider each of those thoughts. So instead of just glazing over and saying, yeah, sure, that sounds great, someone put it, you actually have to go, no, I value that thought over that thought, which is a really powerful learning process that you go through. And it's actually through the learning, that's where all the value of our product is. It's the starring and the learning and the empathizing with other people that creates more buy-in to the end result, which is the key value of our product.
That's great.
It's like writing a tweet. Scarcity of letters.
Yes.
Characters.
Dave, you did a great job.
Thanks.
Let's give it up.
Thank you. High five. Woo. All right. Next up, we have Michael DeLege, VP of Technology and Corporate Strategy for General Fusion.
Thanks very much. So the transformation of the world's energy supply, the world's largest industry, that's the challenge of our century. And that's a transformation and the consequences if we fail that is going to affect every person on Earth and generations to come. So with that in mind, General Fusion is looking to nature for inspiration, because fusion is really nature's way of making energy. Fusion warms up our world and lights up the stars in the sky. It's the process that occurs at the center of the sun, where the crushing temperatures and pressures force atoms of hydrogen together into helium, fusing, and a process where a small amount of mass is turned into a whole lot of energy. And when we harness fusion here on Earth, it's going to have tremendous benefits, because fusion is clean with no emissions. It's inherently safe. You can build fusion power plants anywhere, close to centers of demand, and we have enough fuel on Earth extracted from water for a few billion years. So that's going to do not too badly. And fusion has made a whole lot of progress. In fact, over the course of 30 years, fusion science has advanced exponentially, as fast as Moore's Law. Not a lot of people give it credit for that. And so we're beyond the point now where we're talking just about fundamental research, and we're changing the question to, how do we go about building the best possible fusion power plant? The progress has been made by some pretty exotic machines, talking about machines like this giant magnetic bottle called a tokamak. Large superconducting magnets that hold super hot gas and circulate it, fusing without it touching the walls. Or giant lasers, in fact, the world's biggest lasers, focused onto a pellet the size of a pea in a billionth of a second, crushing it to extreme pressures and forcing a flash of fusion. Of course, these don't exactly look like the kind of technologies that you can turn into something that's going to be economically viable and practical as an electric power plant. They're certainly not that's going to compete with a burning pile of coal. So while they've made tremendous progress and have continued to deliver major leaps forward in fusion science, we need to look elsewhere. And that's where General Fusion comes in. Because what General Fusion is doing is taking these decades of advances in fusion science and using it to reinvent a process called magnetized target fusion. Magnetized target fusion is a technology that lends itself to using advances in material science and electronics, in industrial technologies, technologies we already know how to scale, and looking to build the most practical possible fusion power plant. And in a few short years, General Fusion has gone from basically nothing to 65 scientists and engineers. We've become the world leaders in this technology. And we're moving quickly. We're working with experts in the United States and Europe. We're building key subsystems at or near full scale, like this plasma injector. Think of it like a big fuel injector that preheats fuel to a few million degrees. Or this large prototype of our compression system. The center there is about a meter across with 14 big pistons around it. A power plant would be three times the size with 200 of those pistons, delivering energy into the center, focusing it, and creating a burst of fusion on each pulse. And none of this is easy, of course. What General Fusion is doing is pushing the boundaries of science and engineering, aiming squarely at a practical and economically viable power plant that could compete directly with and displace fossil fuels, because that's a trillion-dollar opportunity. And the discovery and the breakthrough that brings fusion science to the world, like the first steam plant, the first electric light bulb, the first airplane will only happen once in history. And we're trying to make it happen here in BC.
Thank you. Great.
So you've already got one vote from Dave. And can you tell me a little bit about where the science is right now in terms of converting the fusion process? It looks like there's some efficiency ratio through the mechanical pistons, for lack of a better term.
Well, what we're trying to do, can I just show a quick glimpse? Key things we're trying to do. A, we're trying to show we can build the subsystem technologies. They each have to do certain things before we can go about trying to build a full-scale plant. We're also doing a fair bit of experimental work to demonstrate the behavior of the physics of when we compress this gas up to the conditions we expect. And all of those pieces are trying to come together over the coming, you know, next few years before we can get to this stage and say, okay, now we know enough, we're going to raise enough capital to build a full-scale machine. So we're in that range.
And your time frame on R&D cycle?
On R&D cycle in terms of iterations?
Yeah.
Well, we move pretty quickly for our space, and maybe compared to sort of software coding, it's not as quick, but we've had experts from around the world come in. We had one from Los Alamos up just a few weeks ago who said, I've never seen a team moving this quickly in this space. So, you know, we're moving very, very quickly.
What are the top 1 to 3 obstacles that are standing in your way, and how are you going to overcome them?
Well, the biggest challenges are technological. What we're doing here is we're accepting that we're going to take some science risk because we're pushing down a path towards a power plant that could compete with electric generation, right? So we're eyes are squarely focused on that. And so we have to overcome some of these technology risks. And so those are the biggest ones, for sure. It's in the developing and proving out of the technology.
Okay. That's great.
Fusion.
There you go. Thank you. Next up,
please.
Jeff Christofferson, technical sales manager for Inukten. Did I pronounce that right?
No.
Well, you're going to correct me.
Inukten, ma'am. Thank you.
Inukten. That was our second guess.
Yes.
All right. How do you do, folks? Thank you for being here. I'm Jeff Christofferson. I'm technical sales manager at Inukten Services in Nanaimo, British Columbia. Yeah, thank you. We employ 50 people. We've been in business 26 years. We have 15 engineers on staff. Inukten is in the business of providing access to confined spaces and hazardous areas through our multi-mission modular technology. Robotic access reduces the need for manned entry. This results in measurable cost savings and immeasurable reduction in risk to human life. Our products are submersible, robust, proven, and like a good set of Legos, they can be reconfigured in the field. This ability is enabled by our modular design approach, which allows our customers to maximize their investment by reemploying our products in the field in different inspection scenarios. Alongside our cameras and sensors, we often deploy tooling to allow the user to carry out activities in these remote environments. Over our 26 years, we have spun off 4 of our products, which are now separately held private entities. The first is VideoRay. This ROV is the number one selling ROV in the world. Seymour Marine employs 12 people making their ROV. Recce Robotics bought the VGTV product. This was the first robotic vehicle to find victims in the rubble of the 9/11 attacks. Finally, Crystal Cam makes an extremely robust, rugged, submersible camera, and the President Brady Colancy is sitting in this room. Seymour, Recce, and Crystal Cam are all in Nanaimo, British Columbia. Some examples, the first from our customer Pacific Gas and Electric. They had a piece of metal in a mile-long municipal gas line. They had to get it out because it presented a threat to their pumps and valves. They already had one of our 2-kilometer crawlers. We put a manipulator module on the front. They found the piece of metal. They got it out of there so they could get their gas main back online with confidence. Next example is from the oil and gas sector as well. We had a customer in Dubai who literally sunk $20 million in an oil well subsea, and somebody came along and damaged it. They had to figure out how to get in there and assess the damage. We created a new vehicle based on some of our existing technology, our mini track modules, our submersible camera modules. We went 60 meters below the mud line. We assessed this well, the customer gave the report to the wellhead owner so he could make an informed decision about resuming production. Next example comes from one of our nuclear customers, Florida Power and Light. This is an example of the aging infrastructure problem that we're all going to have to deal with sooner or later. They had a leak in the containment area. They had one of our cameras. We gave them the ability to get the camera into the containment area, and one slide too far. From that ability, they were able to assess the damage. They were able to schedule repair during their next shutdown. The reactor stayed online during that inspection. Final example from our mining customer, they wanted to drop a camera 1/2 mile into the earth and assess a vertical borehole. We gave them that ability by leveraging one of our existing camera modules, taking some of the fiber optic technology from our long-range crawler, and we got the job done. And I'd also like to say we delivered a very similar system to the nuclear waste isolation pilot plant in Carlsbad, New Mexico. We have offices in Toronto, Aberdeen, Hangzhou, China, Singapore, a wholly owned subsidiary in Houston. We have resellers around the globe. We have exported globally in our 26 years, and we are currently on track with Dow Chemical to reduce their man entry by 40% at their facility in Freeport, Texas, which they say will save them millions of dollars.
Well done, well done.
Thank you, Jeff. Great work.
Thank you.
Okay, Jeff, I do have a question. You mentioned that you've productized some, you've productized this, and I'm curious, you've done it in a few different areas, and then you also have a customizable one. Which is more profitable for you, and why not just focus on that one that's providing the most profit?
We pride ourselves in being capably creative. At least 50% of what we send out the door has been a new twist to our old products, or our modules brought together in a different way, like I said, like Legos, right? We would love to do that. The market for that is smaller. So we also sell our standard systems to people who can afford those, because customizing and putting our engineers to work is a bit expensive.
Right, so you basically created it for a one-off and then resold it.
There are many examples. We have done that. We have also taken products that our customers have come to us. We created it for that customer, took a look and said, oh boy, that's great. Let's productize it.
What's something you haven't built yet that you can see on the horizon that you'd like to use this technology for?
Something that might use artificial intelligence to think for itself.
Winning hearts. Okay.
That's good.
Good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, Greg, let's have you rock the stage.
Thank you. Zymeworks is focused on engineering drugs for cancer and autoimmune indications. We are a company of 77 employees. Our main office is here in Vancouver. We have a branch office in Seattle, and our funding is derived from multiple sources, including angel investors, pharma, venture capital, and pension funds. Zymeworks is normally thought of as a biotech, but we don't think of ourselves that way. We think of ourselves as a tech company that does biology. And that's distinctions most manifest in the way the company was founded and the way it's grown. Zymeworks started in 2004 with a few thousand lines of Python and C code and a handful of hand-me-down servers. That Python and C code was the nucleus of a comprehensive drug modeling platform that's capable of predicting how drugs will behave physically and behave biologically. For the first three, four years of Zymeworks' existence, we were focused on building up this modeling platform. And by 2008, the platform was sufficiently well developed that we could actually start designing anti-cancer drugs. By 2011, those designs had progressed to the point that we were able to sign a major co-development deal with Merck, one of the largest pharmaceutical companies in the world. 2014 saw a major transition for us in moving our modeling platform from our own internal servers and have it run on the cloud, which enabled a vastly larger scale for our modeling projects. 2014 also saw us sign a co-development deal with Eli Lilly. In 2015, we signed a deal with Celgene. And recently, we just announced a deal with GlaxoSmithKline. These are some of the largest and most innovative bio and pharmaceutical companies in the world. 2016 will also hopefully see us test our drugs in humans for the first time. And this is a remarkable moment for us because there's a direct connection between that code in 2004 and that little vial of drugs that will hopefully save a cancer patient's life. That connection can be seen in the process we use to engineer drugs. We do not start in the lab. We don't even have a lab. We start with a modeling platform that combines machine learning, data mining, and physical simulation, and operates on bioinformatics data, structural biology data. When that's combined with our visualization software, that enables a rational engineering-based approach to drug development, rather than a fraught and uncertain discovery-based approach. Of course, drugs do eventually need to be tested in the lab, and we outsource all our laboratory work. This validates the drug designs and gives us more data to improve our modeling methods. This engineering process puts Zymeworks in a position to capitalize on three major trends. The first is computing. There's a massive amount of computing power being made available in the cloud, and there's concomitant improvements in data mining, simulation, and machine learning algorithms. Of course, those algorithms require data to operate on, and there's been an explosion in the growth of genomic sequence data and structural biology data for our algorithms to assimilate. Finally, lab work is being rapidly commoditized. By outsourcing all our lab work, Zymeworks is able to minimize its costs and maximize its flexibility during its development process. Taken together, these trends make Zymeworks a remarkable business opportunity, but much more important than that, it makes Zymeworks an opportunity to change lives. Thank you very much.
Greg, can you give a little bit more texture? How many people are in Zymeworks right now?
I'm sorry?
A little bit of your organization, just overview. Based?
It's based in
Vancouver?
Vancouver,
how many people?
77 employees.
Okay. And where are you getting, you said the data sets for training for your machine learning algorithms coming from all over the world?
Yeah, I mean, it's a remarkable combination of data. A lot of it is publicly available in the protein data bank and through the NIH and its various resources. Some of it, of which we've developed over time. You know, one of the advantages of our process is the more we do it, the more data we get. And because it's an engineering process, not really a discovery process, as we iterate, we learn and the process gets more and more efficient. So we collect our own data and that becomes a library that bootstraps the next generation of our design process.
Great.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next up, we have Janice Sheem, President and CEO of Neurio. Welcome to the stage. All yours.
The internet generates a wealth of data that companies like Google and Facebook actively analyze to better understand users. This helps companies innovate so they can provide more value through their products and services. At Neurio, we aim to apply the same premise, but to energy data, because in today's digital age, so much of what we do evolves around electrical energy. So if we monitor and analyze energy consumption, we can see the habits of appliance use and therefore infer user behavior. This is incredibly valuable and new information that hasn't been previously accessible for anyone who's looking to innovate. So at Neurio Home Intelligence, we're a hardware and software company that monitors energy consumption and solar generation. With a single sensor, we can monitor the home's total energy use, and with cloud-based algorithms, break it down into individual appliances without requiring a device on every single appliance. This helps provide insights to homeowners and companies about what's going on in your house. So gone are the days where you're wondering after you've left your home if you forgot to turn off your oven, or marveled at a mysterious energy bill that is much higher than you thought it would be. The reason why we can do this is because individual appliances that are plugged in pull power in a very distinct way, which we call an energy signature. So with our sensor that's installed into the breaker panel, it measures total home energy, sends it to the cloud, and it's here that our algorithms can then pull out the individual energy signatures out of the total home load to know what's on, what's off, and how much power it's pulling. Because we operate on an open platform, you can see the results of our analytics on our apps as well as on third-party apps through our open API. The first industry that we're applying this technology to is the solar industry for two reasons. Number one is because solar companies are challenged when it comes to communicating the value of solar. But what a difference a visualization makes. So Lyndon Reeve, the CEO of one of our customers, SolarCity, said they had the highest uptake of residential solar after they started offering customers the ability to see how their home is generating and using power if they signed up for solar. The other application is that solar companies are always looking for ways to increase their revenue streams and improve their business model. So by having more insight into how energy is used in the home, they can do a better job managing power and helping customers save money. So here's an example of how our technology works. These two graphs are the same home in the same 24-hour period. The blue is energy consumption, the gray as well. And then this orange part here is solar. So you can easily see when solar is generating more than the house is using. When you know what all the appliances are in the home, you know what its own potential is to offset its own solar generation. So this blue bar in the bottom is AC use. And you can see that when there was more solar being generated, we could have turned on the AC to pre-cool the home at a time when it wasn't pulling power from the grid. So users have benefited a lot from the device. They've said it's been worth the investment, it's been a dream to use, and there's been countless stories about how homeowners have saved money. One house in particular in the UK is now saving £500 a year because of Nurio, which is a pretty good savings considering that the price of the product is $179 a user. In 2013 is when we launched our product on Kickstarter, and we've since shipped 70,000 units. In 2014, in the first year of commercialization, we did $4.8 million revenue and ended last year at over $8 million revenue, projecting $13 million from the solar industry alone this year. But that's not the only industry we're interested in. We're also talking to partners in the smart home space, smart appliances space, as well as in healthcare for remote home monitoring. So for those who are interested, we're also raising our Series A, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to take them. Thank you.
Top of mind for you.
I think I wanted more clarity. You mentioned you were going after solar companies, so you're selling B2B. Are you seeing yourselves going into the consumer market as well?
Yes, so we're doing that already through Amazon, Home Depot as well.
Okay, and which do you see more potential in?
Yeah, in the short term, I see more potential in the solar industry for 2016, because that's where we have great business partners, where we're getting a lot of volume from, and then looking into 2017, revenue diversity, moving out of the solar space into other industries.
Great.
And each appliance generates its own signature through your sensor?
That's right.
What should I go home and unplug right away?
So if I were you, I would put your home entertainment system on a power bar. So what I found, that was my TV, my amp, and my subwoofer, I was pulling about 200 watts of load even when my whole system was off, but still plugged in. So that's like two incandescent light bulbs. So by turning that off on a power bar, I actually started saving 40% off my energy bill.
Clearly a class A audiophile person right there.
Wow. No kidding. No kidding. Well, thank you so much, Shanice. That was great.
Okay.
Really,
thank
really
you.
Good. Nice job. All right.
That was great.
Next up, we have Jeremy Hilton, VP Processor Development at D-Wave.
Thank you. I started with D-Wave Systems back in 2000, and I've helped grow the company from a small brain trust of quantum physicists to the first organization in the world to build and apply quantum computers in the world. But you're probably asking, what is quantum computing and who is D-Wave? So quantum computing, first, is a whole new paradigm of computing. It leverages the most fundamental effects of the universe, quantum mechanics, to perform computation. A quantum computer will be able to do things that traditional computers can't do. And D-Wave is the only company in the world that has built quantum computers that organizations are using to tackle some of the hardest problems we face. Google, NASA, Lockheed Martin, Los Alamos National Lab are a few examples of organizations that are using these computers today. I have a short video clip from folks at Google that gets at some of the fundamental effects in quantum computing. So let's have a look at that.
Quantum physics puts everything into question.
It defies every intuition you have about the natural world.
Quantum is a very strange regime of physics.
Things can exist in this state of superposition where they could be like ghosting on each other, where they could be this and that at the same time.
Entanglement.
Quantum entanglement.
Two objects, if they're quantum mechanically entangled, are still strongly related to each other, even though they can be a vast distance apart.
The notion of the multiverse. There's a whole family of Hartmuths in different states and going through different experiences and different life trajectories.
The famous one is quantum tunneling.
Tunneling
is the slippage between universes.
For a long time, people thought those effects only existed in the microscopic domain.
Like atoms, electrons, photons.
But really, it's the theory of our universe.
So if you want to build a quantum computer, you want to incorporate those new phenomena into information processing.
Classical computers, which we rely on for everything, are reaching the limit of their ability to increase in speed. This is the end of Moore's law. But quantum computers have the ability to solve unimaginably complex problems in very short amounts of time. And these are kinds of problems that classical computers could take eternity to solve. This plot demonstrates the potential of quantum computing, the ability to solve near impossible problems exponentially faster. Some of the toughest problems that our society faces fall in this area of the curve where classical computers can't find solutions. And D-Wave is working with customers to find solutions to these kinds of problems in areas like cancer diagnostics, financial risk management, space exploration, energy distribution, and even cybersecurity. And this is just a start. Quantum computing is in its infancy, the sprouting seed of a profound technology revolution. At D-Wave, we're challenging the idea that computing has hit a limit, that classical is all there is. With quantum computing, we're better armed.
That was all great. Right, well done, well done.
So, Jeremy, how many principal competitors exist in the world right now who've brought to market production units and had companies like Google and NASA purchase them?
So D-Wave is the only commercial company building quantum computers. All of the other efforts are small research scale efforts.
Yeah, so you're really out ahead in an important area.
That's right.
What's an example of something that you're solving now with quantum computing? And what do you want to solve in the long, like you're personally the thing you're most excited about solving?
The most exciting thing we're working on right now is in cancer diagnosis. So we're combining knowledge of personal genomics with cancers that people are experiencing and looking for customized solutions in chemotherapies to help improve disease survivability. That's an active area of research. And I mentioned several areas that are all really important. And I think this is a huge opportunity for our customers.
Wow. A couple of years from now, can we time travel from one side of the stage to the other?
Not time travel, but teleportation. Yeah. Not a couple
I stand
years
corrected.
From now. Probably
what's
10
the difference?
Or 20.
Just, oh, right. Just not going back in time. Gotcha.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
That's a little bit of a quirky question.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Next up, we have Chris Wagner, President and CEO of Contextual Genomics.
Hi, thank you for the introduction. Contextual Genomics is a company we take in people's cancer tumors. And we look at those tumors and we look for mistakes inside the DNA in those tumors. And based on those mistakes, we are able to recommend drugs or clinical trials for those patients that specifically target the mistakes inside their DNA. And this company was formed through an interesting perfect storm. And the perfect storm, there's really two events to this perfect storm. The first event is something that Ray Kurzweil speaks about a lot, which is the decreasing price of genomic sequencing. In fact, some of the other presenters have alluded to this. And if you think of your DNA inside your body or inside a cancer cell, it's really like a great big book. And inside that book, there are spelling mistakes. And sequencing is able to find those spelling mistakes. And we're able to find them so effectively now that because of the decreasing cost of sequencing and because of the increasing ability to produce a great amount of data from sequencing, that we're able to offer this to anybody who has cancer. So just for perspective, what we do now in our laboratory 10 kilometers from here, we can do in 24 hours for less than $1,000, which 10 years ago used to cost about $1 billion to do and would take years. So this has become, it's an incredible progression of technology. And as everybody knows, one of the great places to start and run a company is where technology is scaling like that in an exponential way. And the second component of this perfect storm are some really astute investments that have been made by the province of British Columbia in genomics and genetics here locally. So we have a talent pool in BC unequaled to anywhere else in the world. I would rather be running a genomics company here than any other jurisdiction. You couldn't pay me to leave. This is the place to do it. And so the combination of those two things led us to start a company. And this company and our vision is to make this high complexity molecular testing of cancer, this personalization of medicine, available to any Canadian who needs it, starting here, and then we're going to move internationally with that. So this vision was compelling enough that several different groups have provided us millions and millions and millions of dollars to do our basic research. And I'm really happy to report that as a result of all of that money, we now have developed a product that is ready to go and launch all across Canada. And Canada is where we're going to launch it first. So this is quite exciting. I really want to thank a couple of groups that have been so instrumental in helping us do this. One of them is the province of British Columbia, who's been so supportive of our organization. And the other are some companies that have helped us out along the way, Life Labs, Pfizer, AstraZeneca, and Sanofi. We hope that we have taken the advice and the money that has been provided to the company and done things that can make all of us proud. We are on the verge of saving a whole lot of lives in a very direct and meaningful way, and we're ready to now export this technology outside of Canada. So thank you.
Chris, you were mentioning the amazing cost reduction in terms of sequencing in a reasonably short period of time. Are you seeing that curve continue into the future? And if we're just linking with that, a little bit of the Berkeley announcement on CRISPR, how are you thinking about sequencing and manipulation?
Yeah, it's a good question. So the cost of sequencing has had this beautiful downward logarithmic curve for the past 15 years. And 2 years ago, it stopped. And I thought, uh-oh, what's going to happen? And last year, it dropped again. So I think it's hard to predict in 1 or 2 year periods what happens. But if you start looking at 3, 5 year periods, it just keeps going down. In fact, I think we will be giving away sequencing in probably under 5 years.
Interesting. And do you see it being rolled out in private care first, or is this something that you're also going to roll out in the public care system?
Well, it depends on the country. So in Canada, it's a public care initiative. But the actual deployment of genomics is really best done by a company because we can achieve the scale to... We're not confined by a geographical constraint like a province or a country. We can scale to the world. And as a result, we can do it cheaper and faster and better than a public pay system could.
Great. Thank you so much,
great
Chris.
Stuff. Thank you for Thank sharing you. Today, Chris. That was great. All right, next up, we have Denny Unger, CEO of Cloudhead Games.
Let's put our hands together.
Hi. I'm Denny Unger, CEO of Cloudhead Games. I'm also the creative director of the company. We build VR experiences and solutions for VR. This isn't the really bad VR of the 90s. I went through that, as many of you may have done, and it made me sick and was a bad experience generally. This is VR that we've been waiting for. This is the VR that we've been promised. It's the realization of a dream. So VR really does change everything, and if you're not paying attention, you should be right now, because it's not coming in 10 years, it's not coming in 5 years, it's coming this year, it's coming right now. And some of the biggest companies on the planet are pushing it forward. So we have Oculus being pushed forward by Facebook, HTC being pushed forward by Valve, and Sony releasing their PSVR platform as well. This is going to have profound ripple effects in every industry. Everybody in this room, it will affect you in some deep and profound way very soon. So in education, training, tech, design, commerce, medical, and of course entertainment, it really is going to have that profound effect. This is the new internet. The way this is going to work is content is going to sell this idea to the public. So this is the proof in the pudding. Content is going to sell the hardware. The hard challenges of designing the hardware and making it all work have been figured out, but the software is now what's really going to sell this to the public. So that's one area that CloudHead has really innovated in the last 3 years. We've created a number of solutions that are going to drive this technology forward. So a couple examples of what we're doing. Locomotion in VR is very hard. It's a really difficult problem because if you don't do it right, you run the risk of making people feel sick or nauseous. So we created a system called Blink, which essentially allows you to track a user in a physical volume and then project that space deeper into the virtual space, into the virtual world. And it does so without making people feel sick or uncomfortable. It's a very comfortable and intuitive experience. Another thing we've created is, we call it VR performance capture. We actually think this is the first time it's ever been done. And what we're doing, instead of putting an actor in front of a green screen with a Lycra suit and ping pong balls, we decided to take a different approach. It's an inside-out method of capturing performance data. We put the actor in VR so they can actually see the scene that they're acting towards. No imagination required. And we're doing all this without using camera-based systems. We think that this will be widely adopted in the industry, in both film and in the video game market. And it's going to really change how people do things, how they do performance capture. So gamers and enthusiasts are the first adopters. They will drive this forward. So that is where our target audience is initially. We have a four-part franchise called The Gallery that we're launching this year. We're partnered with HTC as a launch partner. We're also partnered with Oculus as a launch partner for their Oculus Touch. And we're also working on a port for PlayStation VR. So this is a four-part episode. It's really just the beginning of what we're doing, and it really puts into practice all the tools and tech that we've created over the years. And it's really just the beginning because this has application everywhere. I love my team. We had very, very humble beginnings in my garage with three guys that were just, you know, VR geeks, essentially. And we've quickly grown to 15 people. And most of those guys are from AAA studios like BioWare, Electronic Arts, Relic, and Riot Entertainment. We also back that up with a really competent biz dev team. And we plan on being a 30-person studio over the next 6 months. That's it. That's me wearing a bunch of VR headsets in an uncomfortable way. Yeah. I think I'm done.
Well, that's done. Great. Thank you, Denny.
Hey, Denny. What's your favorite VR experience right now?
Well, you know, I've tried many, and a lot of them make me feel sick. So, no,
that's called the vestibular comfort problem.
Vestibular disconnect.
Yes.
Yeah. So, Valve is doing some really incredible work with VR. They've created something called a portal experience. Really, the HTC Vive has enabled VR in a really interesting way that really skirts a lot of the issues with vestibular disconnects. You can physically walk around. There is no disconnect between what your eye is seeing and what your body is doing. So that's been kind of the fundamental change that's happened in the last year.
And are you motion capturing anchor points?
No. So I mean, when we put an actor into VR, we can give them virtual cueing. So we have virtual cue cards. We can put, you know, markers on the virtual stage, and they can actually control the environment that they're acting towards. It's really exciting seeing them act in that environment because it's like it's an eye opener to them. No longer do they have to imagine what they're doing. Right.
That's cool. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Jenny. Great job. Let's give an extra loud round of applause for all of our finalists
presenters.
Or contestants. So, please, you have a couple minutes to vote. We're literally waiting for you to vote, and we're going to announce the winner in just a couple minutes.
Get your app out. I think we saw eight great companies, eight great presenters. We're still
generally
on
time. Do you want us to read them out again, or do you guys have them? Can you see them all in your voting
mind?
I can read them out again if you need to.
We're going to read them out one more time.
Okay. So we had Dave McLeod, the CEO of Thought Exchange.
Virtualization of data.
There you go.
Scarcity of voting.
Michael Delage, VP Technology and Corporate Strategy of General Fusion.
Change the world, infinite power supply. 3 billion years.
I love this. Jeff Christofferson, technical sales manager for Inuktitut.
Building sensors, places where people don't want to go.
Greg Lakatos, senior scientist for Zymeworks.
Applying machine learning to new data sets to solve complex problems that can't be tested in the physical world.
You know, you're really smart. It's like you could run like a multi-billion dollar company. Okay, Janice Chi, president and CEO of Neurio.
Audiophile expert. Who is going to save us all money on our home appliances?
Love it. Jeremy Hilton, VP processor development at D-Wave. Teleportation.
First person to build a quantum computer in the room.
Brilliant. Chris Wagner, president and CEO of Contextual Genomics.
Again, pretty amazing technology that's going to be profound social change for us as people in the community.
And Denny Unger, CEO of Cloudhead Games.
VR. By the way, the stuff that Denny and team are doing is recognized globally as a leader. I got a little domain expertise. So great work, Denny.
Nice work, Denny. All right. How many of you need more time to get your votes in? The app. You crashed the app?
Okay.
You guys gotta be nicer to the app. You gotta talk to it. You gotta be really friendly. Coax it. It'll come. Give it some.
There's a whole crew of people backstage. Tiffany, are you looking panicked?
How are we doing?
We're going through a web portal.
They have 10 seconds. This is it. 7, 6, 5. No pressure. 2, 1. There we go.
All right.
Okay.
Tiffany, are you happy with the voting process? Tiffany's thumbs up.
Tiffany, did you get the check?
We apologies for anyone who didn't get a chance to vote.
Yes.
Sorry about that.
You can send Don mean tweets later. Are you on Twitter?
Some days.
Some days. Okay. There you go. What's your Twitter handle?
I don't really want to get a whole bunch of tweets.
I do. Mine's Techlins. You can follow me right now, so I have more followers than Don. Yep. How many followers do you have?
The board members of Twitter.
Neville, you are back up.
Hey.
You are back up. This is perfect. Let's hand over the podium to you. You ready to announce it?
I'm not ready to announce it, but I will be momentarily.
What's your Twitter handle?
It's at NKNUPP. Yeah, lots of followers, and some of them are interested. Depends on the day.
What was your? Do you get to have a favorite presentation, or are you not allowed to be biased?
No, like I'm not allowed to be biased. I don't even know who the winner is, although Tiffany's going to tell me. She's got the winning name on the big check.
Actually, and this is a great opportunity to thank Tiffany, who's basically been living on 4 hours sleep for the last 6 days organizing all
this. You, Tiffany,
thank you, Tiffany,
for all of your hard work.
You know, judges always say, it was such a close competition, and Tiffany just showed me the statistics, and there's four bars on the chart there that are within 1 or 2% of each other. Just before I make this presentation, I hope everybody in the room, the next time you read an article talking about the demise of or the worry about innovation in Canada and where we're going and the productivity of this country, just say, I'm sure you're paying attention to what's going on in BC. All of the presentations were very impressive. Yeah. The ground being broken, whether it was from software or to robotics and everything in between, and the focus on healthcare, many things of concern to the entire planet, just fantastic to see. So my thanks to all of the candidates and all those who supported them in the competition. Now, as we mentioned earlier, just to remind you, the winner of the competition will receive a $5,000 cash award, as well as $120,000 from the IBM Global Entrepreneur Program, which is a credit schema that gives them access to a number of technologies that help them take their business idea to that next level, as we described before. And so without keeping everybody wondering any longer, I'm happy to announce that the winner has gone to the Thought Exchange. Ooh. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
You want to say a few words?
No, actually, I will say one thing is that was a really amazing group. I'm shocked that we won. And to sit there beside cancer research and solving the world's energy problem, we are humbly accepting this award as an overstatement. So thank you very much, everyone. Thanks, everyone who voted for us.
All right. Woo! Congratulations. There you go.
Sorry. Ah, yes, okay.
We're good? Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Neville, thank you.
Woo! We have fans in the audience. All righty. Now.